Again, a very good morning to all the participants. I am Dr. Bhupendra Singh, as the introduction is given already by Anamika. I am currently working on the post of assistant professor at Civil Engineering Department, IIT Jodhpur. So today we have two lectures, and our first lecture is concerned with the hot and warm bituminous mix design. So I would like to start my lecture. First, we will be discussing what are the different materials which are used in like bituminous mixes, and then we'll be moving on to the design procedure. So talking about the difference between hot and warm mix asphalt, I think we already know there is the difference between production temperature. In hot mix asphalt, the production temperature reaches up to 160 to 190 degrees Celsius. It means we have to heat the material up to that like temperature in order to prepare a mix. And when we talk about the warm mix asphalt, the preparation temperature of warm mix asphalt is 20 to 40 degrees Celsius, lower than as compared to the hot mix asphalt. So because the temperature is lower, that makes warm mix asphalt environment friendly also and pocket friendly also, because in order to heat the material up to that temperature, we have to burn the fuel. That is why hot mix asphalt has gained popularity in the past two decades. And talking about the performance also, earlier there were some performance issue which were with the warm mix asphalt, but nowadays there are different techniques of producing warm mix asphalt, and many studies have been conducted, and it was found, many laboratory studies also and many field studies also, and it is found that the performance of warm mix asphalt is as good as hot mix asphalt, and in some cases it is even better than hot mix asphalt. So due to these advantages, hot mix asphalt is being preferred nowadays. Talking about the differences, in the design procedure, when we design hot mix asphalt and warm mix asphalt, the procedure is almost same, because they are the same material, the components are the same, everything is the same. Just the production and mixing temperature is different. And what are the differences that arises due to that, that I'll be discussing at the end of this presentation. So in this presentation, I'll be starting with the what is bituminous mix. We will be discussing some of the basics. Then we will be moving on to the what are the different materials which are associated with bituminous mix, and then stepwise we will be taking on to the design procedure. So starting with the definition, bituminous mix. So bituminous mix, and it is also called asphalt mix. So bituminous mix or asphalt mix is a mixture of heated aggregates uniformly mixed and coated with bitumen. So this is a straightforward definition, and from the definition it is clear that bituminous mix consists of two main component. One is your aggregate, and second one is your bitumen or asphalt binder. Now moving on to the next. See, there are different criteria on the basis of which we can classify bituminous mixes. One criteria I discussed just now, and that is based on the production temperature, and based on the production temperature we can there is classification. And the second classification criteria, which is most widely used, is type gradation. What kind of gradation our bituminous mix is having? So based on the gradation, our bituminous mix can be classified into the three major categories. First one is dense graded, second one is open graded, and third one is gap graded. So dense graded is most popularly used, and bituminous mix. And in dense graded, what do we do? In dense graded, we have the well distributed aggregate gradation throughout the entire range of sieve. So you will find every size of aggregates there, starting from the bigger sizes to smaller sizes to further smaller sizes up to the fines. So the example is given in this figure one. Here you can see that the circles here are denoting your aggregate sizes. So here we can see that bigger circles, it means bigger aggregate sizes are there, then smaller than that, and further smaller than that, and the fines are also there. So in these type of dense graded bituminous mixes, you will find your air voids are very less. So that is why they are preferred in the construction of your national highways, state highways, and all type of important roads. Okay. Now coming to the second type of bituminous mix, which is there, it is open graded bituminous mix. So in open graded, as the name from the name only, we can see that it is open graded, means all the grades of aggregates are not there. So in this, you will find only like bigger grades of the aggregates, bigger sizes of the aggregates are there. This second figure you can see, the sizes of aggregates are there. Just because the bigger sizes are there, smaller sizes are not there. So air voids which are present in these kind of mixes are very high. Here also you can see that the air voids are very high, and air voids ranges from 18% to 22%. Okay, so it is very high. Some of the examples which are used for open graded mix are OGFC and ATPB. So these are the these are used in some of the special cases where you have to provide the drainage and other facilities. In those cases, we use our open graded bituminous mix. Now, third type of mix is gap graded. So from the gap graded, again, from the name only, it is clear that there are some gaps in the gradation. It means there will be one size of aggregate, then some of the sizes will be missing, and then smaller size of the aggregates will be there. In the figure, third figure, we can see that the bigger sizes of aggregates are there, then intermediate sizes are not there, then the smaller sizes of aggregate there. So there is gap in the gradation. And due to that only, this gap graded mix is, it is named gap graded mix. Okay. Now high content in the gap graded bituminous mixes, you will find the high contents of coarse aggregate. It means up to 70% to 80%. See, it is very very big proportion of coarse aggregate. 70% to 80% coarse aggregate are there, and then intermediate sizes are not there. Filler, then you will find the filler. Filler content is also very high. It is up to the 10%, and the binder content also in your gap graded mix is very high. Okay. So now these are the different type of grade. So now how will we decide which kind of gradation and which kind of other things we want? That will depend upon the type of job that is on the field. Which kind of conditions are there? Which kind of traffic volume, traffic loads? It will depend on that. But what are the desired property? Why do we design the mix? We design the mix to achieve some desired properties. And what are those desired properties that we want from our bituminous mix? So first thing that we want in our bituminous mix is that it should have sufficient bitumen for durability. We know that what happens when we prepare the aggregate bituminous mix, then your bitumen asphalt binder, it forms a film around the aggregates. And like these two aggregates, when they have a bituminous film around them, when they come in contact with each other, they bound together. So durability of your bituminous mix highly depends upon if we have that sufficient film thickness or not. If we will not have that sufficient bitumen in our mix, then that film will not be formed uniformly around the aggregate surface. It means at some places that film will be there, at some places that will not be there. And in the absence of that film, what will happen? Bonding will not be good. And if the bonding will not be good, then your pavement will not be durable. So for that purpose, our bituminous mix should have sufficient bitumen from durability point of view. Now, the second desired property that we want up from our bituminous mix is the sufficient stability and flexibility to satisfy the need of the traffic. So what is the purpose of bituminous mix? From the bituminous mix, we construct the pavement, and pavement is constructed to support the traffic volume and traffic load which is coming upon them. So ultimately, that is a task. Okay. So if it will not be stable enough to support the traffic load which is coming on it, and it then what is the point of making these roads and other things? So our bituminous mix should have sufficient stability. Now coming to the flexibility, what will happen if our bituminous mix is not flexible enough? It means it is very hard and brittle. Then what will happen when the traffic load will come over it? Instead of going under the elastic deformation, it will crack under the application of the load. And when the cracks will come, then it will start the deterioration process. So our bituminous mix should have sufficient flexibility also. Now coming to the air voids. So general perception about air void is that air void should be as low as possible. Yeah, we try to lower our air void content in our bituminous mix, but there should be sufficient air voids also. Why? Because whatever the urea will come, it will fill the voids which are present in the mix, mineral aggregates. So that should be there. Then after the completion of your construction work, we lay our bituminous mix and then we compact it with the help of the roller. And then after that also, when the traffic comes over the ear, again secondary compaction take place. Okay. And if those extra air voids are not there, then what will happen? Then cracks will come. So in order to accommodate that secondary compaction, our bituminous mix should have sufficient air voids. And apart from that also, we know that bitumen is a viscoelastic material. When the summer comes at high temperature, thermal expansion of the binder also takes place. So if your air voids are not present in your mix, then what will happen? Your bitumen will expand. And when it will not find the voids to fill inside your bituminous mix, then it will come onto the surface of your pavement. And that is called the bleeding. And you guys must have seen that bleeding also. It is in the news every year in the summer, they say that when the bleeding starts, then the bitumen comes on the top, and in the news, they show it every year. So that problem comes. So in order to check all these problems, there should be sufficient air voids also in our bituminous mix. Now talking about the air voids. Now air voids, okay, there should be sufficient, but there should be some maximum limit also. Why? Because our bituminous mix will have excessive air voids, then your water will percolate through it. And we know the water is very harmful for our flexible pavement. When water comes in contact with the bitumen, then stripping start, and when the stripping start, then on the application of the traffic load, your pavement deteriorates, then fatigue and reveling and all those kind of distresses come into play picture. So there should be some minimum limit of air voids also, and there is a maximum limit of air void is also there. Now coming to the workability. Workability is important from your construction point of view. When the construction is taking place, then in order to properly lay the material, uniformly lay the your bituminous mix, and then for the compaction, workability comes into place. So whatever the bituminous mix that we are generating, it should have sufficient workability. And finally, from the safety is a big factor. From the safety point of view, our bituminous mix should have skid resistance so that vehicle doesn't slip over it. So these are the basic desired property of our bituminous mix that we want. And in order to keep these properties in mind, we design our mix. Okay. So now we are coming to the steps to design the bituminous mix. So I will be discussing stepwise one over the another. So why do we design bituminous mix in one line, if you want to summarize it? Because we want to determine the combination of bitumen and aggregate that will give long lasting performance. So in order to keep that in mind, we have to select the proportion of the different quality and proportion of the different components that we are going to use in bituminous mix. So first step to design the bituminous mix is aggregate selection. First is basically our material selection. So what are our material? Aggregate and bitumen. So we select the aggregate and we select bitumen. Then after that, sample preparation, we mix and compact. We mix both these components together and we compact that. And after the compaction, in India, we use Marshall test. So we perform the Marshall test, then there are some volumetric calculations that we perform, and then we from that we get some like parameters, and we try to optimize that parameters to get the optimum asphalt binder content. So now one by one I will be discussing all these steps in detail. So now coming to the aggregates. So aggregate forms like major portion of your bituminous mix, like 70 to 80, and in some cases more than 80% also. So it is very important that we select the aggregate right. So what are the how can we select the aggregate right? Because there's some property that we want from our aggregate, that our aggregate should be hard, it should be tough, it should have it should be durable enough, and all those things. So keeping these property in mind, over the years a number of tests has been developed to check these property of our aggregate, and we perform this test. We take the representative sample from our aggregates, we perform this test, and there are some limiting values which are provided by the specifications. So there are different specifications all over the world. In India, we follow the specification given by the Ministry of Road Transport and Highways. Okay, so we perform this test by the standard procedure which is given, and then we check whether our aggregate is the value that we are getting from our aggregate are within the limit or not. And if they are within the limit, then it is fine. And if we select that aggregate, if that is not within the limit, then we have to change our aggregate. So there are number of tests, like these are the very basic tests. These are taught on your UG level. So I will not be discussing them in detail. So these tests include impact test, LA abrasion test, soundness test. Impact test is conducted in order to check the toughness of our aggregate. Then LA abrasion test is there, which is performed to check the hardness of our aggregate. Soundness test is performed to check the durability of our aggregate. Then flakiness and elongation index is there in order to check the what is the shape and size of our aggregate. Then water absorption test is there, stripping value test is there, and specific gravity test is there. Now stripping value test is very important. Now what happened, we can select the best quality of aggregate and best quality of bitumen also, but if they are not compatible with each other, then our payment will fail. So there should be compatibility also. So in order to check that compatibility, stripping value test is also performed. Now the impact test, LA abrasion test, soundness test, flakiness and elongation test, and water absorption test, these tests are performed by following the standard IS 2386. Okay, for stripping value we follow our specifications, which is given in IS 6241. All these tests are straightforward, just the specific gravity is a little different. Apart from it, all the tests are straightforward. You perform there is standard procedure, you perform the test and you check whether the values are within the limit or not. If they are within the limit, then we use that aggregate. If they are not within the limit, then we reject that aggregate and we change the source of our aggregate, or we perform some corrective measures also. Okay, so now talking about the specific gravity are little more complicated than all those tests. So what is specific gravity? We have studied in our school also. Specific gravity is defined as the ratio of weight of a unit volume of material to the weight of an equivalent volume of water at 23 degrees Celsius. But when we talk about the specific gravity of our bitumen, then there are three specific gravity which are there. So first is apparent specific gravity, second one is the bulk specific gravity, and third one is the effective specific gravity. So in order to understand these specific gravity, understand these different specific, what is the difference between these specific gravity? For that understanding, that we have to understand the your structure of a aggregate particle. So here in this figure, in this red box, you can see a single solid aggregate particle is there. So in that aggregate particles, you can see this this textured part, which is your silver and in color. So that is your solid aggregate part of your aggregate particle. Then apart from that, here in this figure, here you can see there are some voids which are available on the surface of your aggregate. So this air void is there, this air void is there, all those air voids are there. Now these air void consist of two part. One part is where your one part of the your air void which can be percolated by just water only, because water has lower viscosity. So water will be able to percolate the smaller air voids also. On the other hand, bitumen is highly viscous, so bitumen will not be able to percolate all the voids that water can percolate. So air void contains two portions. This cracks contains two portions, one which can be percolated by what just water, and second portion, this black portion, which can be percolated by water as well as bitumen, because water can percolate any void which your bitumen can percolate because its viscosity is lower. So like this, this air void which are present on voids which are present on the surface of your aggregate particles can be divided into the two parts, one which can be percolated by water and second which can be percolated by bitumen and water. So we have prepared this phase diagram. So here we have divided these volume into three categories. First one is the volume of the solid part, this solid part of the aggregate. So that we have given V3. Second is what part which can be percolated just by the water, this white part. We have given it V2 value. And third one is the part which can be percolated by both bitumen and water, this black portion, which have given it V1 value. Now, when we calculate specific gravity from the definition itself, you can see it is the unit volume of the ratio of the weight of the unit volume. This volume is very necessary. So the difference between these three specific gravity is the volume that we consider to calculate it. Okay. In apparent specific gravity, we just take into the consideration of solid part only, V3. Only that volume we take into the consideration. Talking about the bulk specific gravity, from the name, again, the name is self-explanatory to bulk. In bulk, we take all the things. So in bulk, we take all the three volumes, V1, V2, and V3. So from that, we get the bulk specific gravity. And third one is effective specific gravity. So in effective specific gravity, we consider only the solid part, which is V3, and the part which is percolated by water, which is V2. So these are the two part which we consider. So like this, we calculate this different specific gravity by following the standard which are given. Okay. So now moving on to the next topic. Now we have selected our aggregates and we have find out what are those values, and from the values we have decided, okay, our aggregates are fine. But in field, now you have to get the gradation. So gradation charts are given in your Morse specification, different sieve sizes are given, and with respect to those sieve sizes, what will be percentage passing from those sieve sizes, those are given. But in the field, you will not find that your aggregates will of individual sieve sizes. Okay, you will find three or four piles of the aggregates there, three or four or five or two, whatever the number of there, but you will not find each individual sieve sizes aggregates which are corresponding to individual sieve sizes. So now in these three or four piles, we have to mix them together in order to achieve this aggregate gradation which is given by the Morse. So how do we do it? Yesterday, Professor Praveen Kumar discussed those methods in detail, like the Roth-Fudge method and triangulation method and all those methods. But all those methods take much time. So in field, what is the method that we adopt? It is hit and trial method that we adopt in order to achieve the aggregate gradation from these three or four piles of the material. So what do we do? First, we take the representative sample from each of these piles of aggregates, and we sieve them in the sieve. And from the sieve, we get what is their individual gradation. Now we have to decide in what proportion we have to mix all these individual pile of aggregate together to achieve our desired gradation. So for that, in the field, we use hit and trial method. So hit and trial method can be easily done with the help of your Excel sheet. There are some now there are some your small softwares also. Dr. Sabu from IITBH, so he has developed a very good software that we also use sometime for the gradation purposes. So that software I'll not be discussing here. I'll be discussing just the Excel sheet. From the Excel sheet also you can prepare, and from that also you can use the hit and trial techniques to get the optimum combination of all these things. So let us discuss that in brief. So here you can see these are the sieve sizes, corresponding sieve sizes which I have been given, and what are the specified limit. These are the specified limits is given. Now we have the four piles of aggregates here. First one is 22.4 to 53 mm, second one is 13.2 mm, and third one is 6.7 mm and stone dust. These four piles of aggregates have been given. So first we will take the representative sample from each of these piles, and then we sieve it. From the sieving, we got these gradation. This is the percentage passing. So for 22.4 to 53 mm, we got these gradation. For 13.2 mm size, we got this gradation. For 6.7 mm, we got this gradation. And for stone dust, we got this gradation. Now we can see that these gradations are very different from the specified limit which has been given to us. Now we have to mix them together. So how will we do it? Here you can see here this 22, 23, 30 and 25. We have to change these proportions in such a way that it makes 100% also, and this combined gradation that we are getting, it should be within this specified limit. So you will change, you will like take it above, bring it down like that. Hit and trial techniques you will use in such a way that the sum of it is 100%, and as well as the combined gradation is within the a specified limit. So this is the hit and trial technique that is used most widely in our field. And other than that, as I told you, other techniques are also there, Rothfuss method and triangulation method and all those. But those are very complicated method. And if the simple methods are there, they have the limitations that only one or two type of, aggregates can be used, or three type of only can be used. So those are not very critical when we are working in the field. In the field, we use this hit and trial technique only. So now we have selected our aggregate. We have got our gradation also, whatever the desired gradation we wanted. Okay. So now moving on to our second type of material, which is in their bituminous mix. This material is bitumen. Bitumen acts as the binder in bituminous mix. Bitumen makes only 4 to 6% part of the, in most of the cases, only 4 to 6% bitumen is there. But bitumen, performance of the bitumen affects the performance of your mix like significantly. See, when we talk about the performance, there are three types of performance in mainly that we consider. First one is your rutting performance, which happens at high temperature. Second one is your fatigue performance, which happens at intermediate lower temperatures. And third one is your cracking, low temperature cracking, which happens at very low temperature. So talking about the rutting, in rutting, the role of the bitumen is not as critical as compared to the other two type of performances. So in rutting, bitumen plays a medium type of role. Now talking about the fatigue, the role of bitumen becomes critical. So the fatigue performance of your asphalt mix will depend highly upon your the performance of your bitumen. Talking about the low temperature cracking, here the role of bitumen becomes very critical. So the performance of your low temperature cracking performance of your asphalt mix will highly depend upon the performance of the bitumen. So this is why it is very important that we choose the bitumen which depending upon the site conditions and your traffic and other those parameters. So that is why we will discuss how do we do that. So bitumen is a tar-like mixture which contains hydrocarbon, and we all know that it is derived from the petroleum. It can be naturally also, and it can be through distillation process also, and it is majorly used for the road surfacing and roofing. In the West, it is also used for the roofing purposes. In India, mostly it is used for the road surfacing. Now, what are the desired property that we want from our bitumen? First, the bitumen should not be highly temperature susceptible. What is temperature susceptibility? Temperature susceptibility is the change in the behavior of a material with the change in temperature. So we want that our bitumen, because bitumen, we already know the properties of bitumen depends on the temperature. Okay, because at high temperature it is a fluid, at low temperature it is it is a solid material. So that is the basic property of bitumen, but we don't want it to be very high temperature susceptibility. It should not have, because what will happen if your bitumen is very high temperature susceptible, then at higher temperature it will become very soft, and when it will become very soft and the traffic load will come over it, it will go under the deformation and rutting will happen. Okay, on the other hand, at lower temperature, if your bitumen is very temperature susceptible, it will become very hard and brittle. And when it becomes very hard and brittle and lower temperature and the traffic load will come, it will crack under it. So in both these cases, the problems, there will be rutting problems also, and there will be fatigue problem and low temperature cracking problems also. So we don't, for that reason, we don't want our bitumen to have very high temperature susceptibility. Now, second one is the viscosity of the bitumen at the time of mixing and compaction should be adequate. This is very important point. Now, why viscosity is important? Because if the viscosity of your bitumen is not adequate at the time of mixing, then what will happen? It will not be able to form a uniform film around your aggregate. And if that uniform film will not form, then the bonding of our aggregate will not be adequate. And again, the durability of our mix will not be adequate. So that is why viscosity is another very important point of our bituminous mix. Okay. Now, third point, there should be adequate affinity and adhesion between the aggregate and bitumen. This is the point that I discussed when we were discussing our properties of our aggregate also, that we can select excellent quality of aggregate, and on the other hand, we can select excellent quality of bitumen. But if there is no compatibility between them, it happens more. It happens most of the time, because one set of aggregate which is you check its aggregate impact value, compact LA abrasion, and all these value, water absorption value, it is excellent. All these property, it is having excellent properties. On the other hand, you will see your bitumen is also having excellent properties. But when you construct the road fails very early. That is because there is no compatibility between your bitumen and aggregate. So that should also be checked, that there should be adequate affinity and adhesion between them. If there will not be adhesion between them, then what will happen? Then your then your cracks will generate, and when the cracks will generate, water will enter them, and when the water enters them, then it will destroy the whole pavement within no time. Okay, so that is why it is very important. Now, how will we decide which kind of bitumen we should use in our pavement? So the selection of the bitumen depends highly upon the environmental condition, traffic condition, and all those. Basically, it is decided on the environmental condition of that place. So here you can see two tables are there. One table is given by the IS 73, and the second table is given by the MORTH. So we can follow any of these. These are the guidelines. So depending upon this, engineer on the site, he can decide which kind of aggregate we can use. So according to the IS 73, it is based on the suitable for 7-day average maximum air temperature. If your 7-day average maximum air temperature is less than 30, then we can go about VG10, and so on. So if we are constructing a road in Jammu, so most probably your VG20 will be fine. But when we are constructing our road in Jodhpur, then VG40, we have to go for the VG40. Okay. Similarly, in MORTH specifications are a little more detailed. Here they talk about the lowest daily mean air temperature also. Not just the high temperature is also there, but low temperature is also given. So based upon that, we can decide what kind of vitamin we want to use. Okay. Now, okay, we have decided the vitamin, and when we will get the vitamin, how do we classify it? So there are many techniques. Like earlier, we were using the penetration grade of grading of the vitamin. In penetration grading, what we were doing, we were performing the penetration test on our vitamin. And when we were performing penetration test, then we were checking what is the penetration value. And depending upon that, we were telling that, okay, this is 60 by 70, this is 80 by 100, this is 50, 40 by 60, like that. Different grades were there, depending upon the like your penetration value. But penetration is not a very good way to grade our bitumen, because we already know that bitumen is a complex material, and it has its behavior changes drastically over with the change in your temperature. So how can we decide the grade of our bitumen just based upon a test which is not very practical also? And just one temperature which we are checking, okay, at 25 degrees Celsius, this is the penetration value, and we are grading our bitumen. So that was not a very good way. So that is replaced by viscosity grading in India. So viscosity grading, because we know that the viscosity is a very important property when we talk about the pavement construction and mixed design. So depending upon the viscosity of the absolute viscosity at 60 degrees Celsius, we check the viscosity of our bitumen at 60 degrees Celsius, and depending upon that, we classify our bitumen. If our viscosity at 60 degrees Celsius is coming from 800 to 1200 pies, then it is VG10. Then if it is coming from 1600 to 2400, then it is VG20. If it is 2400 to 3600, VG30, and 3200 to 4800, it is VG40. So that is the basic parameter on the basis of which we do our viscosity grading. So there are four types of viscosity grade: VG10, VG20, VG30, VG40. Apart from it also, other tests are also performed, such like the penetration test, your kinematic viscosity at 135 degrees Celsius, flash point from the safety point of view, solubility from your from your purity point of view. We will see whether some organic material is not mixed with in our bitumen. Then softening point, we check in order from the workability point of view, test on residue that is after aging. So all these tests are performed, but the basic parameter on the basis of which we decide our viscosity grade is the absolute viscosity at 60 degrees Celsius. So we do this test, and from that we check what is the grade of our bitumen is, whether that is the grade that we want to use in our field. So now we have decided, okay, this is our aggregate we have decided, bitumen we have decided. Now what is the next step? Next step is the preparation of the sample to perform our Marshall mix design. So for the preparation of the sample, what do? We have to decide what is our mixing and compaction temperature. Okay, and mixing and compaction temperature, how will we decide? That we will decide based upon the viscosity ranges. So, viscosity ranges, okay. So what happened, because we have discussed that bitumen should have adequate viscosity at the time of mixing and compaction. So in order to decide this viscosity ranges, experimental program took into place, and from the extensive research, it was found that for the proper mixing, your viscosity of your bitumen should be 0.17 plus minus 0.02 Pascal second. Here, see, this range is given, this white strip here, this is the mixing range of viscosity. Now for the compaction, on the other hand, your viscosity range should be 0.28 plus minus 0.03 Pascal second. So these ranges we have got. Now we have to find out what is the mixing and compaction temperature of our bitumen. So for that, what will we do? We will check the viscosity of our bitumen at 135 degree Celsius and 165 degree Celsius. Here, see 135 degree Celsius with the help of rotational viscometer. So this is rotational viscometer. From the rotational viscometer, we will find out what is the viscosity of our bitumen at 135 degree Celsius, and then we will also find at 165 degree Celsius. Now here we are making an assumption. That assumption is not correct, but that is the method we are following at the moment. So here we assume that between this point, the viscosity of our bitumen will vary linearly. Okay, so see this and this, we are considering that the viscosity between this point is varying linearly, although this is not correct, but this is the assumption we are making. So this point, we connect them with a straight line. Now we want to check what will be our mixing temperature. So we know this is the viscosity at y-axis. So, and at x-axis you have temperature. So we know what is the range of viscosity that we want for our mixing temperature. This is that range. For that range, we will move, and wherever it is cutting that line. So from here, we can see that 160 degree Celsius is our mixing temperature. Similarly, we will do for compaction temperature. For compaction again, within the range, we will go and we will check. So around 148 degree Celsius is our compaction temperature. So using this method, although this method is not very correct, as I told you, because because we are assuming that the viscosity between these two points will be linear, will vary linearly, but it is not correct. But this is the standard practice that we are using. So using this method, we will find out whatever will be our mixing and compaction temperature. So then we will start. Now we have got our both the materials also. We have got our mixing and temperature also. Mixing and compaction temperature also. So now what will we do? We will prepare our Marshall sample. So Marshall sample, we know how does it work. We take the 1200 grams of your aggregates, then the binder content we select 3 to 5, and by weight of the mix, and then we add that binder into your mix. We already know mixing and compaction temperature. We mix it and we compact it, and there is one condition that the temperature difference between the aggregate and bitumen should not be more than 12% anywhere. Now the number of blows that we provide, generally we provide 75 number of blows on the each face of the sample. But apart from it also, if that depends upon the design traffic, if your design traffic is less than 0.01 MSA, it means your design traffic is very low. So then number of blows that we should provide is 35 on the each face of your sample. Similarly, if your design traffic is between 0.01 to 1 MSA, then the number of blows that we provide is 50 number of blows on the each side of the face of our sample. And if your design traffic is greater than 1 MSA, then we provide 75 number of blows. So we prepare the sample by using this number of blows, and then we keep it for 24 hours at at room temperature, and then we use the sample extractor, and we extract the sample from the mold, and then we keep it into water bath at 60 degree Celsius for 30 to 40 minutes, and then we take some measurements. We all know what are those measurements. We take weight in air, weight in water, the height of the sample, and the weight of the sample, and all those measurements we take. Now, then we perform the Marshall test. So we already know what is the Marshall test, so I will not be going into the detail of it. So in Marshall test, again, as I told, we keep the sample in water bath for 30 to 40 minutes at 60 degrees Celsius. Then we put it into the sample your machine, and then we start loading. So loading rate that we use it 50 mm per minute, it is the loading rate. So we test the sample. The stability value from this test, we get the two values, the stability values and your flow value. So what is stability value? Stability value is the maximum load that your sample will be able to get before failing. And flow is the corresponding vertical deformation at maximum load. Okay, so here you can see there are two dial gauges. This bigger dial gauge, it shows the load which is your sample is able to take, and your this smaller dial gauge, it is showing you the vertical deformation. So from there we get the stability value and flow value. Okay, and other calculations, other measurements we had already taken, weight in air, weight in water, and all those things. Now the next step which comes is volumetric calculations. So volumetric calculation is very important. So in volumetric calculations, some of the parameters, first we have to perform the experimental procedures to measure them. Some three parameters we measure, and from those three parameters we calculate some parameters by using the different relationship which are there. So measured parameters are, we find out the bulk specific gravity of the aggregate, that is very important. So there are two standards which are there which we can follow. First one is ASTO T85 and second one is ASTM C127. Second parameter that we measure by experimental procedure is theoretical maximum specific gravity of the mix, that is called the GMM also. So for GMM again, there are two specifications. First one is ASTO T209 and second one is ASTM D2041. And the third parameter is bulk specific gravity of the mix, that is called the GMB. GMB is also again one specification is given by ASTO, which is ASTO T166, and second specification is given by the ASTM D276. So now we have these measured parameter. We have some other parameters that we measured before that Marshall test, and from those parameters we calculate other parameters such as air voids, voids in mineral aggregates, void filled with bitumen, effective specific gravity of the aggregates, and percentage of absorbed bitumen. Okay, these are the parameters that we calculate. So now, since the time is not that much, I will not be discussing derivation of these parameters, but I'll be giving a brief outline of these parameters. So see, this is the typical your Marshall sample. In that you can see aggregates are there and bitumen is there and your air voids are there. So if we convert it into your phase diagram, then what we can see, so there are different fractions. So this this aqueous blue, it shows your bulk volume of the aggregate plus absorbed bitumen, because some of the bitumen will be absorbed by your aggregate also. So these two are the volume of aggregate, and this dark green, this is your absorbed bitumen. And because whatever the left quantity of bitumen is there, that is called the effective bitumen, because that bitumen will only be participating into the film creation, okay, around the aggregate. So we called it effective bitumen. We are showing it VEB. And then there will be some air voids also. Okay, total volume of the bitumen can be divided into the two. First one is the bitumen which is absorbed by the aggregate, and the remaining part of the bitumen is called the effective bitumen. So these are the different. From this, we calculate the GMB, GMM. formulas that we use and for the calculation of these parameters. Just a minute. Then after that, your VMA is there, air voids is there, VFB is there, GSC is there, PB is there. VMA is voids in mineral aggregate, AV is your air voids, VFB is void filled with bitumen, then PBA, all those parameters are there and these are there. So we calculate all those parameters volumetric calculations are done. I am not discussing, you will find all these derivation of these, all these parameters in your different books also, and your MS2 also, you will find it there. So if you want, I will share MS2 with you guys. So now, we come to the portion. Now OBC selection, how will we select our optimum bitumen content or optimum binder content? So there are many different parameters which are used all over the world. But as I discussed, Asphalt Institute has given a criteria on the basis of which we select our bitumen content, OBC content. And that is, it says that OBC should be decided with respect to the 4% air voids in the mix. So see here, we can see we have drawn this curve, bitumen percentage, like there will be different samples with different bitumen content. We will draw it with respect to their air voids. So at y-axis there is air void, and at x-axis there is bitumen, different bitumen percentages are there. So the bitumen percentage with respect to the 4% air void, we consider it as optimum bitumen content. But that is not the only parameters. That is the basic parameter, but the other parameters also it has to fulfill. So what are the other parameters? There is minimum value of the stability also. So it should fulfill that, okay? So see, at whatever the bitumen content we got it here, we will check whether it is fulfilling the minimum value of stability or not. Here it is fulfilling. Then other value, flow values is given. So we will check whether whatever the OBC that we are getting with respect to 4% air voids, it is fulfilling the flow values limit. It is within the flow value limit or not. So this is the minimum limit and this is the maximum limit, whether it is in between that or not. Then there is VFB also. Again, minimum and maximum limit is there. Again, we will check whether it is within that range or not. And finally, VMA is there. VMA also we will check. It is better than the minimum limit or not. So if your with respect to 4% air void, your bitumen content is following all those conditions, then we will choose that bitumen content as our optimum bitumen content. Okay. So see here, the value for different parameter is given. This is for, I think, bituminous concrete. So there are, for other layers, these parameters value can be changed also. So that is all given in our MORTH. MORTH is the is called the Bible of road construction in India. So we'll follow whatever the specification which is given in there. So if like one of these parameters, it is not fulfilling, then we have to change our aggregate gradation within the limit only. We can change it a little bit. We can tweak it a little bit. By tweaking it, maybe we can be able to attain it in the next time we have to revise our bituminous mix. So that is how we select our optimum bitumen content. Now, this was all about the design, mix design of our hot mix asphalt. Now we will talk about cold mix asphalt also. So what was cold in case of the cold mix asphalt, warm mix asphalt, sorry. So we know that there are different techniques of finding out to obtain warm mix asphalt. Warm mix asphalt can be foaming techniques are there, your organic additives are there, chemical additives are there, inorganic additives are there. So all these additives have different techniques of taking down your compaction and mixing temperature. Some of them, they will reduce the viscosity of our bitumen. Some of them will reduce the friction between aggregate and bitumen. Some of them will use different techniques. So there are different techniques of warm mix asphalt. At the moment, there is no standard specification to decide the mixing and compaction temperature. That depends because not every warm mix additive, it will reduce the viscosity in conventional manner. Some will reduce the friction, as I told, some of will reduce the friction between aggregate. And so researchers are working on it. In fact, Dr. Nikhil Sabu is working on it. And maybe in the near future, we can get a way to decide the mixing and compaction temperature of our warm mix asphalt. In most of the cases, your manufacturers only, the manufacturers of the additives, they only tell you mixing and compaction, approximate mixing and compaction temperature, and we follow that only. So maybe in the near future we will get some of the concrete procedure to get standard procedure to obtain the mixing and compaction temperature of warm mix asphalt. And apart from it, we will get the mixing and compaction temperature from there. Apart from it, the procedure will be similar only. Just the mixing and compaction temperature will be different than the hot mix asphalt. Other than that, we will perform the same Marshall mix design. We will follow the same volumetric calculations. We will follow the same. We will see the same parameters, and we will decide our optimum bitumen content with respect to the 4% air voids, considering that all the other parameters are within the range or not. Okay, so this is all. I would like to announce that all the important content in this presentation are taken from MS2, which is given by the Asphalt Institute, and the MOTH specifications for road and bridge works. Most of the images which are taken in the present presentation, they are taken from the Payment Interactive, some of the research articles and other sources using the Google image platform.